So the title is probably a little bigger than what I would focus on today, because China fintech ecosystem, that's a very big topic. I'm not sure I'm in a position to really paint the whole picture, but I hope to dive in some specifics on our practice on helping serving small businesses in China. Also, maybe related to some how we use big data AI, and are we really knowing what we're doing here? As lots of you questioned. And then in the end, I might comment a little bit on how we work together, actually, with the credit bureau agencies, with banks, together to serve the industry. So I'll skip one slide on the whole kind of big picture on it is a problem, especially in developing countries, to serve underserved personal or small businesses where they cannot really get funds from the financial, formal financial institutions. Here I gave a kind of simplified example on the cost of serving small businesses. This is not too far away from truth, but this is the data from China, and also investigated a few Southeast Asia countries. So typically, customers pay, or small business pay, and this is uncollected loans, typically, they give 30 to 50%, actually from a decent lender, not those loan sharks, 30 to 50% APRs for loans. And it takes weeks for them to get it, because the bank has to take the receiving person, process the paper documents, all that. And the banks are not evil either, because they charge 30% to cover their cost. The risk is usually ranging from 10 to 20% for the cost of risk. And also operational-wise, since they have to sign a huge ground truck to collect all the information and things are processed manually. So it's usually 10, 15%-ish for the operational cost. So they are kind of, to keep their business sustainable, they have to charge 30, 50% for that. That's a very common situation in China, in Southeast Asia. So, and also here's the problem we want to solve at Alibaba and Financial. We're inspired to help them do business better, easier, and at Financial want to give them funding easier and less painful to help them do their business. So, this is for people living in Asia or at least visiting Asia. This is something I think is typical in developing countries or not developed countries. If you walk on the streets in Bangkok or in Beijing or in Hangzhou at 10 p.m., if you do that in D.C., probably all shops are closed and everything. But in Hangzhou, or those that I mentioned, you know, lots of those small businesses, like those mom and pop shops, they still open. Sometimes I truly think they're the backbones of the economy of the developing countries, because they open for hours, probably all night they make a profit, a few dollars, but they work hard. They try to use the skills to, you know, to pay the living for the family. They're truly most of the customers we try to help. And on this picture, I think for those, this is a kind of a small shop owners, they sell the breakfast, it's probably very early in the morning. In the past, for those kind of mom and pop shops, it's very hard or impossible for them to get loans because they get cash. There is no record for them to have a paper document income, and no banks would lend to them. However, I think recently, with the mobile, with the digital payment, I think things start to change. Here on this picture, if you notice the small blue thing, that's a QR code there, that's an Alipay logo. So those shops, they start to use those QR code to collect payments. And those customers, actually also use their mobile phone with our payment products. They can use their balance. They can also have credit pay to pay their bill, to pay for the transaction. And with that, those small shop owners now have data where we can see how much is their sales. Are they growing? Are they sales trending down, trending up? How's the business? Who is buying there? What are they selling? And with that, we actually can give them loans where, you know, we can also manage a good risk level. And while we also don't need to send bikes to their shops to collect their data, to be able to give loans. So here I gave kind of, let's continue on that example on how that is done. Here I actually got an actual example from a noodle shop in Qinghai province. For those of you who know China, Qinghai province is a pretty remote area, less developed, not many branches and banks presence there. And this is a young shop owner, 23-year-old, opened a noodle shop. And he started to use the QR code to collect customer payment. So we see he has stable kind of monthly sales of all the units in RMB, so in 20,000. Then they gave him loans of 20,000. And he used this loan to actually open another shop. And you can see on that left-hand corner shows his sales is pretty much growing because now he doesn't need to worry about the funding. And on the right-hand side, I show how he get the loans. That's basically, I apologize, that's all in Chinese. But basically, that diamond thing, under that number, that's 20,000, that is a loan kind of credit line. Can use up to that credit line. On the bottom, on the small transactions, that's kind of every 10 days, we increase his credit limit. Because his sales is growing, and we actually calculate that, actually in real time, but we increase that every 10 days for him. For people of you who understand those small business owners, they really manage their credit very carefully, actually, and they use that very frequently. And at the end of the day, they like to take off their cell phone to see how much I made. I actually grow. You know, the more money I make, and also my credit line increase, that truly kind of gave them a sense of successfulness and satisfaction. So that's the example of how we help those kind of mom and pop shops. The second example is people all know where they started this, we kind of affiliates with Alibaba. And here I want to give an example for a seller on the Alibaba platform and how for those retailers on the platform, how easy it is for them to get credit. So here I also give an example. This is a small shop called Beef and Family, which is selling goods in the warehouse, there is a count of what's the type of products, how many weight and everything, and also a process to validate if it's a true, real inventory, not some like bricks or stones. They're indeed beef. Once he gets the goods in the warehouse, we actually gave him a loan, an inventory loan, because now we see how much he gets there. And then he sells them on the platform, and we actually gave them, but haven't received the payment from customer yet, we transfer that loan to account receivable financing. And we automatically kind of change the amount of the inventory that got low, we get change the amount of the loans he can get from the inventory loan, but increase the amount of receivable until it's paid. So it's all automatically, he doesn't need to worry about something, paper to us, it's automatic and paperless process. And underlying that, we actually have lots of models, statistical models to help for us to evaluate that. For example, we have models to measure the merchant's credit worthiness from his own, from all different sources, which I'll talk more later. We also have models to evaluate how much the inventory worth, because I don't really know how much leaf worth, but I do have the sales on the Alibaba platform and beyond. There's a complicated algorithm to match similar products, what's the sales, and et cetera. And lastly, I want to give the example is about how we truly want to, our goal is not only to give them loans, but also to help them kind of set what's their financial need as a total package, not really give you lending and make some money. So maybe I'll cover it a little bit. Mark introduced, I worked in Capital One for 14 years. And for those of you who know Capital One, or it's developed from a tiny little community bank in the early 90s to a pretty large bank in the States, probably not the big four or five, but the second tier, number six or seven. It's mentioned, it's labeled itself as a information company happened to be in the banking industry. It actually makes its progress with using information as well. But still, I want to see the differences. What we do at Capital One is we calculate the profit very diligently, because we're serving underserved market. We have to be sustainable. So first few months when I went back to M Financial, I kind of always, whenever what decision my team is making, our decision is how much money we're making, what's the profit. And gradually I learned we do want to make things sustainable, but that's not the only goal we're making. I think the way of approaching things slightly different there is how we help customer, what's their pinpoint, how we make that easier for them. I think then you'll find out actually that also helps your business as well. So kind of think a little bit more broadly than calculate every single decision has to be this profitable. So coming back, this is a product beyond lending loans and some an interest difference. We also want to help them again, think about those mom and pop shops. How do they manage their wealth? Because again, they cannot afford to hire a personal financial advisor to help them how you kind of make your hard-earned money to earn a little bit more for you. So we design a product for them. For every sales they make, here is an example of a fashion store owner. They have those offline stores, not big for employees, but they have both offline stores and also a store on Taobao, where every sales from their both stores actually get into a monetary fund, which we call Yuanbao, the green thing there, where they actually earn the interest without them have to manage the money. Right now, I think the interest is between 4 to 5%, which isn't, because there's no threshold for, like, even if it's $1, $10, it's will be deposited in an account. And when they need those money, they actually can withdraw that to their Alipay accounts or to their bank card. It's almost like a zero can be drawn, so there's no limits on how much withdraw, time, and et cetera. So those can help them to earn, make sure their money can make them richer even beyond just the sales. One thing I didn't show here is actually we also are developing a information center for those slightly bigger stores to help them to know how much sales they make every day, what's their inventory, what's their cash flow, just to help them manage their business better. So, this is a topic being talked a lot by these days on how we use data, how we make business sustainable. I give a brief example here. So I think, with all due respect, I think in the last 2 days I hear a lot about people talking us as them, as if we're very different species doing very different risk management. I think risk management is the new data and technology and everything. I think it's like people say on the betting, something new and something old. There's something old which will never change on how you manage the credit. It has to be how much you can afford, how much are you willing to pay. If you are you, I don't think those change ever. But how you do it is changing. So, and also for, so here I give an example here. If we look at the right side first, again, picture that the picture I showed about those that small shop selling noodles or steaming buns. They use their, some of them don't even have a kind of special enterprise Alipay account. They use their personal account, Alipay. But we want to tell which one is truly just personal account for personal transactions. Which one or which transactions are kind of for small business owners. So here is a pattern actually for Alipay transactions, how we tell a store owner from a personal individuals using kind of a new AI algorithm. So on the very right side, you can see this is actual data actually. That store owner is someone who's selling steaming buns. And you can see there's a center where the store account, where you can see many individuals paying them. And on the left is individual account, which you can see there's really kind of paying AI, but you are just money to build. They're not really businesses. We're not even be able to tell them for the same account which transactions are their business transactions, which transactions are they just, you know, transfer money to their friends. With that, again, customer referral is on that process. We gave them what's loans based on their business transaction where we identified with data. IT system, transactions in everything is on cloud. So a lot of computations, which is very hard to do and very hard, I mean, for people working in the bank, you know, how difficult that IT department to do something in the world. Things are very different at financial there. So we can handle very large computational tasks there. For example, our famous Double 11 Festival, I think we peak time, we actually now have the ability to handle a million transactions a second. And our database is in the unit is EB, I don't know what E stands for, it's E. So lots of requests as a data scientist in my prior life. I know I don't even bother about IT because I'll say I'm dreaming, but now I have that capacity there. So the big data technology and cloud computing is reality at financial. And I put some numbers there, like 3,000 credit policy rules. We have hundreds of numbers and tens of thousands of features there. But I want to stop here actually to say, yes, all these are kind of advanced in big data, but we also obey the basic rules of doing responsible risk management. So one way we manage this to be, because there's something about, I think, even today, it's not in a stage where you put data in a black box and you trust the decision coming up from the black box. On the top level, we do use leverage those big data technology to help us to handle those scattered information, what we call unstructured data. But we actually, on the top level, want to make them in the unit and to be understandable, transparent, and stable. So our risk model, the final risk model, actually looks very familiar to that. It's often a logistic regression on this person. 10 variables you can actually understand. Even I use this example, it will be what's your sales volume. And we check that stability over time, and we validate the case with sales volume. However, this variable itself maybe have underlying tens of thousands of pieces of data pieced together by advanced algorithm. So that's how we kind of merge the old world, or I think the way of universal truth about how to do financial risk with the technology here. And here is kind of our results. Also showing a little bit, we do know what we're doing. So, for small business, focus on this segment. We actually have been serving this segment for 7 years. And over the last 7 years, we have over 5 million customers served. We have over 900 million loans extended. The average home size is tiny. It is 30,000. And the average APR is ranging between 6 to 16%. Again, think about this, our uncollectible loans. And our risk level is less than 1%. Because without that, we cannot afford to offer those APRs. And the customer experience is you probably hear Jack Ma talk about this a lot. So we call 310, means 3 minutes application time, 1 second processing time, and zero human intervention. Because in our, for all these loans extended, we don't have any branches. We don't have a ground truth. As I mentioned, our 600 employees, half of my IT is there. And there is less than 100 of my team, which is the data analyst from data to data scientist to private policy teams. And then we have the unit of the business team, which an accounting separate from our add up, just to 600. serve this many customers which actually underserved by the banking institutes. Actually, back to the 310, we actually think this is actually not exactly accurate to the detail, because majority of our loans doesn't even need 3 minutes. If they do their business online, at the example I gave, they're often pre-approved for their loans. So it's 0 seconds. They just need to click a button that says, I want to have this loan. Says, I agree, then they can get their loans. And the processing time is not 1 second. It's probably a fraction of a second to process that. That's about my, this I don't want to speak too much. This is a picture of PDM. For people who know, that's kind of a partnership with Alibaba, Alipay, where we want to extend our business model globally, but working with local partners. So here is a view of PDM. We work with together, and we now have over 200 million registered users already. There's one last slide, just numbers, I'll skip that. I posted one last point I just want to make, since my title is ecosystem, fintech ecosystem. I want to talk a little bit on how we work with the banks and with our credit bureau business, where we have a few kind of people from the central banks here. So under credit bureau, I think it's not black and white, we don't need them, or our data is garbage. I think it's a combination of both. We actually, in checking or using Euro data for even from the beginning, we're doing our small business transactions. And until today, we actually check millions, send millions requests to the credit bureau to check their credit bureau. I think our position in general is, we do want to make the information less painful to the customer. So for those with very rich information in our system where they use Alipay a lot, they sell online, which is probably the top 20-30% of our customers, we don't check their bureau, but we know enough to give them instant credit. But for the next layers, we actually using our information to make sure they are they're legit, but we do check their bureau to make sure we give them the credit line we deserve, because at the end of the day, they only have partial of their credit features. So that's, and also if you think about, again, that small shops where we have zero credit in the past, and also a profile of our customer, they're mostly, majority of them are in their early 20s. They're kind of new to credit, what we sort of call. We think we are a good platform to extend them small credit, educate them what it is, how to use it responsibly. And then gradually, they will become customers of the banks. And we're actually reporting their payment behavior to the credit bureau. So they start to have record there to show they actually can manage their credit. So I think this is all part of this system. And also to banks, we actually think we focus on small business, really small business, where they don't have loans from banks. But for those, there are some big sellers on Alibaba and Tmall platform, but if their loans are over a million, then maybe again, you have to divide by 7. For US dollars, we actually talk to them, says this is a loan you should serve, not us, because you know they're decent customers, their need is large, we don't want to serve them. So we actually partner with the banks on either they can customer us a good big one, or even for personal loans, we actually have some agreements banks are doing jointly doing the lending. So that's from my view how it works with the two agencies. That's
city, went outside the hotel and was looking for something to eat, small restaurant next to the hotel, and they took my reservation using WeChat, they took my QR code, let me wander around until my table was ready, and then when I came back, they asked me to pay using WeChat Pay. In one of the least developed parts of China, just absolutely amazing. Okay, so we have a few minutes for questions. Oh, Anthony already has his hand up. Anthony already has a microphone. All right.
Trying to use your time wisely. I want to first sort of reflect on the number of times that you use the word help and serve while you're talking. And I find that really impressive. You represent an extremely large organization that sometimes gets characterized in ways that are really not appropriate to the whole organization. You're talking about serving and helping. And there's clearly a sense of mission there. And I just wanted to comment that that's really impressive to see that, and it's really inspiring to see that. And then it got me wondering about how these relationships happen. You're serving and helping very, very small businesses. It seems to me that they probably come to you because they need money and someone told them that they could do that, or maybe you have some outreach to them to try and help them find you. But at a macro level, you must be able to see clusters where you're serving less and clusters where you're serving more. And so you have the opportunity to shift your focus to places where you can help more or help less because you're already helping enough. Can you talk a little bit about how you manage that macro effect in the demand that you see?
Small stores. So there are digital ways to know who they are and how big and small they are. The rural area, the villagers, those are slightly difficult because they're not selling to customers directly. And how do you get them? Again, the key word is we have to have some data of them. The model we have been working, one successful model is there, is we actually have, this is Alibaba's model to start, and then we help follow with the financial need is they, in lots of villages, they always, if you go to the village, they always have a small shop for the villagers. They actually go there and help them to install an app for Taobao and Tmall, where that shop owners can help the villagers to purchase things, because lots of villagers don't even know how to use a digital device to purchase things. So we help the store owners to buy goods for the villagers. And we even use the shop owners to recommend the blending product to the villagers, because they know the villagers. So, and they also help them, once they have produced locally, they can help them how to sell on Taobao. So you have to have a little bit of infrastructure there, because otherwise, how do you know them? But with that, they actually been able to help in that section as well.
So the village shops act as the center on Taobao for
yeah,
the villagers.
Yeah, they call them partners.
Yeah. And then do the provincial governments help set up and support that kind of beginnings of e-commerce in the villages?
We work very closely with the local government. I think they welcome this change because it's helping the leaders, etc.
Time for one or two more questions. Matt has his hand up there. Senator Matt.
Hey, thank you. Thank you, Ms. Kwan. I know this isn't your main area, but could you talk about, with respect to the larger ecosystem, the work you and Financial and Alibaba are doing with creating information resources that you are sharing to the wider community, the Sesame credit score, the other indices you're working on that you are now making available to the wider universe in the Chinese financial sector?
Sure. As you're right, I'm not the expert, but I'll talk as much as I can. I think we think us beyond just lending loans. So our technology and data, we hope is not only for our own business. We hope to enable the industry as well. Some things we do there in a few ways. One, as I bragged about, we have if people don't know, actually Ali Cloud, or whatever the English name, they now have revenue not so shy about from Amazon's cloud. So those big infrastructure, we also have special financial cloud there as well. So we're actually open that up for other financial institutions to do that. So technology-wise, we want to help more institutes can do that. And from up and level, from the information, again, we want to keep the information all to ourselves. We, as you said, yes, we have a Sesame score where we score people using both our internal data and some external financial institutions. And we make that available to other financial institutions as well and then to the customer. We're actually thinking that's not only a way of sharing information, but also a way for, again, credit, managing credit is relatively new thing for a large population in China. We hope for using that to help people know how to increase credit score and how to manage a credit score. We know very well if the whole society knows what is a credit and knows how to manage it responsibly, then we will thrive and other people will thrive. It's not a zero-sum game.
I think we could go on and on, but we'll do one more because Jerome already has the mic. Go on, Jerome.
I am deeply impressed by your presentation and some of the figures you mentioned, and notably the fact that it covers now roughly $125 billion transaction and loans. That's more or less the figure you mentioned. With an APR which is between 600 and 1,200 basis points, which is impressive, which is a third of the previous one. My question relates to the ability to replicate the model in different market segments and in different environments. Today, for example, that's one of the issues I raised earlier, credit insurance industry cover roughly $15 trillion credit transactions with an average cost charged to the policyholder, to the insurer, which is roughly 15 basic points. Not 600 to 1,200, but 15 basic points. How do you think that model you describe, which is impressive, can be replicated in other market segments and in other countries?
I'm not expert in the insurance industry. We do have actually a separate business unit on insurance as well. So a little bit on financial. It started with Alipay, but now with that base infrastructure, we have my unit is personal and small business lending or finance group. We have Sesame Credit. We have an insurance arm. We also have a wealth management arm. So with that, I can see we do have a group of data scientists there working very diligently to use big data technology to help that industry, the information more transparent, the process easier for them. For example, we recently have some new development is you can take a picture and some AI technology can tell whether it's a real damage that your car. Hopefully, a little bit and by little, we can provide proficiency there as well, efficient there as well, but I'm not an expert. As to how we can replicate this model to other countries,
I do think there's a big opportunity there to help replicate this model in other, especially developing countries as well. I think in developed countries like in the States, someone mentioned that, I think he's largely right, the banks has all the data they need. But I don't think that is, and you know there are fintech in the States, but they all have small niche market, people with less information, but that's not a big set. In the developing countries, similar as China, I think those segments are huge and opportunity there is huge too. How we use alternative data to help them at least get a start. And as you can see, we already have our adventures overseas with all the payment establishment. So we hopefully can help them on their credit assessment as well with one, now they have payment information data available.
John, thank you very much. Hugely impressive company.